Hello, my name is Dan Watson with CenturyFile, and I'm going to walk you through CenturyFile document management today. First thing that you'll notice is CenturyFile is a browser-based application, meaning that you can access CenturyFile, be it the on-premise version or the cloud version, from any browser, Chrome, Firefox, Edge, Explorer, etc. When you access CenturyFile, it's going to take you to the login screen, and it's going to ask for a username and a password. So let's go ahead and sign in here as administrator. Once you sign in, it's going to bring you to the home page. And in the home page, you have some areas where you can broadcast information, such as our system messages area right here. And this is a simple area where you could convey anything that you'd like to convey to other users who access the system. Welcome aboard new employees, or we're going down for maintenance or updates or whatever it may be. Certain versions of CenturyFile support workflow, and our workflow surrounds the process around a document and moving it through an approval process per person. And we're going to cover that at a later time. But just know that this is the first area where, as the administrator, you'll see the status of these workflows, as well as being notified if there's a document that needs any of your approvals. Then you scroll down here to the quick stats area, and this is a unique area for each person's login. And we have the bookshelf, and the bookshelf allows us to store documents that we're constantly referring to. So instead of looking for the same document over and over and over again, what you can do is find it once, add it to your bookshelf by clicking on the little link that says add to bookshelf. And what that will do is every time you log in, when you scroll down to the bookshelf, you'll have immediate access to that document. So it just saves you some time and makes it a little easier on getting to that particular document that you may use and refer to a lot. Likewise, we can save searches, same concept. So if we run the same search over and over and over again, instead of having to queue up all the parameters, we can save that search parameters. Now, the results of that search may change, but the parameters of the search do not. So that's a perfect candidate for a save search. We can generate the search results in the search, and then once we've done that, we hit save search and we can name it, and then that way we can queue up that search much quicker and get to the desired results that we're looking for. Then we have binders, and I love binders. Binders is a great way of collaborating with coworkers when it comes to documentation. So what this will allow me to do is create collections of documents through various cabinets, provided I have the access to them, and then assemble these documents into a binder. Now, once I've created the binder and I've added the appropriate documents to it, I can then share that binder with other users in the system so that other users and I could work together on this collection of documents to accomplish whatever task we've been given. Now, once we're done, we can simply delete the binder, or we can export the binder or whatever you'd like to do with it. But what's great about this is the documents never leave their filing cabinet. They're still accessible for all the other users in the system. This is just a collection of documents that we can get to and we can collaborate on. And once I share it out with another user, when they scroll down, they would be notified that there's an additional binder on their home screen that they can have access to. So this could be used in a lot of different ways. It can be used for creating meeting notes or documents associated with a board meeting. It could be related to, in the legal world, where we're creating collections of documents because maybe they're meeting with somebody. And then once the meeting's done, they just simply delete the collection. And the documents stay right where they need to be the entire time. So great feature for collaboration and getting tasks accomplished where we need to maybe collect documents together that may be saved within the system. And then finally, you'll see the checked out documents area right here. And this just simply says that we are a true document management or enterprise content management system, which will allow us to take a document, and let's say the document needs to be adjusted. Maybe we need to change the 2019s to 2020s or whatever it may be. This will allow me to find the document, check the document out, open it up, make the appropriate changes, and then check the document back in. When you check a document out, what it does is it prevents anyone else from being able to check the document out. They'll still be able to search for it, and they'll see the current version of the document while you're working on it. And this on the main screen right here just notifies you that you still have your document checked out and you need to complete editing it and checking it back in. And once you check that document back in, if anyone runs a search for it, they're going to find the most current version or the newest version that you just edited. But what's great about this is it's keeping all the previous iterations of the document, and it's keeping an audit trail of who's doing what inside the system. So we are allowing you to have revision control on all the documents in the Sentry file system. When you're also looking at the home screen, you're going to see some help resources here. These are links that will take you back to the website so that you could open up a support case or look for additional information. And you get a little bit of redundancy right up here at the top, again, taking you back to the links. Most of Sentry Files navigation is really done on the left-hand side of the screen here. And you can expand or contract any of these particular menus. The help screen obviously takes you to, the home screen obviously takes you to these home options right there. And the help area obviously will take you, again, some redundancy, taking you back to our web page, opening support tickets and stuff like that. But where you're going to find the lion's share of the configuration and how we set up the Sentry File will be located underneath this management tab here. And this is where we have our IT settings for our global options. Our cabinet is the structure in which we build out at customize the Sentry file to meet your needs as far as storing and organizing your documents. This is where we would create our workflows within the system, our notification processes that follow a document. This is where we would add all of our users in. And we can even assign those users to groups to make it a little easier to kind of navigate when we're bringing people into the system. But, you know, it's one thing to have our users in the system, but we have to be able to clearly define what these users can do, and that's where the rights come in. And in the rights, we can assign what users can see, what cabinets, and so on and so forth. So if I had a cabinet for HR and a cabinet for accounting, and I had my accounting department and I had my HR department, when my HR employees log in, I want to make sure that I set the rights properly so that they have access to the HR documents, but not the accounting documents, and vice versa for the accounting department. And we can do that. And further, we can delineate what a user can do inside of that cabinet from a rights perspective, all the way from completely advanced administrative rights for deletion and moving and adding documents and whatever they need to do, all the way down to really all they can do is run a search and look at a document. They can't even print it or save it. And anywhere in between to meet the needs of that particular department with the employees as far as the rights are concerned. And all this is encapsulated right there. Now, once you get the system set up, once we get the cabinets in place and the structure in place and the users embedded into the system, most users won't find occasion, or customers will find occasion, to go into this management tab. It's kind of like opening the hood to your car, right? We're going to do it when we need to run a service, but apart from that, we're not going to really mess with it too terribly often. So if we're bringing on a new employee, or if we're employee's position's changing, or if we're removing somebody from the system, we would go into the management tab. But once that's done, we're not really going in there all too terribly often. And in fact, most users won't even see the management tab. This would be limited to a select few individuals. But where most users will spend the lion's share of their time will be on either adding new documents into the system or in searching and finding the documents that are in the system. Well, it's got to be easy to use. So how easy is it to get a document into the system? So let's look at that today. And I'm going to use the word document kind of loosely. Most people think that when we refer to documents, we're referring to paper. And yes, certainly you can take pieces of paper and you can scan them in and we can file them away in Sentry File. But when we say document, it really can refer to any kind of file that you can think of. So it could work with, for example, Microsoft Word, Excel. It can work with PowerPoint, PDFs, JPEGs, TIFFs, MP3s, WAV files, video files, DWF files. So pretty much any file format can be stored and centralized and secured inside of the Sentry file system. You just kind of dictate what you would like to see and how you'd like to store it. The way we accommodate that is through the multiple options underneath the Add Documents area. So we can upload any digital document by just simply browsing to a location on our computer and selecting a file. If we have a dedicated USB Twain-driven scanner, like an all-in-one, we can scan it right here by hitting the Scan option. If we're pushing our scans from a multifunctional device into Sentry File, this is that staging area where you can direct the scans from that MFP directly into the staging area so that we can commit the documents to storage from here. Some versions of Sentry File even have a capture process where we can automate some of this and streamline the process in getting lots of documents into the system. What we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and go with the upload process and show you how simple it is to get a document into the system. And really, you just kind of follow the steps that are laid out here on the screen. Step one is choosing your document. So you're going to browse to the location where you have that document stored. You'll double click on it. You can hit Show Preview here. What this will do is actually show you the document with some navigation options right across the top here, where you can scroll through the various pages. You could delete a particular page. Perhaps you had scanned something and you accidentally scanned the back side, so you have a blank sheet of paper. You can delete that. You could rotate a page 90 degrees or 180 degrees. So if you scan something in upside down by accident, you can rotate an individual page within a document. You can even break the document up. So if you had scanned in 100 sheets of paper, and this is really two documents, both documents are 50 pages, you could tell this to split this particular document at page 50, and it would in essence create two separate documents, even though you only scanned one document at the MFP, making life a little easier for you. Well, since this is just a single page invoice, we don't really need to worry about any of that. And it looks good, we're ready to go ahead and commit it to storage. So then step two is really selecting the destination. What kind of a file am I putting them away here? Is this an HR document? Is this an accounting document? And again, this will be based upon my access rights within the system. Well, this is clearly an invoice, so it's an accounting document. So we're going to go ahead and file this away underneath the accounting cabinet. And now we hit upload and continue step three. The next step is really filling out what we call the index tags. And each cabinet is going to be structured uniquely. And these index tags are completely customizable. You could have one index tag, 100 index tags. They can be mandatory, non-mandatory. They can be text fields, date fields, anything you can think of to help you organize the information that's going into the filing cabinet so that you have a better chance of being able to find it later on down the road. This particular instance, the account wanted to see the name of the entity. They wanted to see the document type identified, and they wanted the date. So this is a perfect instance. What we're going to do is we're going to say, well, this particular company is test company. I'm going to show you a neat little trick. This is a text field where you could certainly type the information in. We also have a great little lasso effect where I can draw a box around the name test company here. And what it'll do is it'll actually capture that information. And all I have to do is now simply click in that field. And what it'll do is it'll transpose that into that field for me, eliminating the need to type. But I could certainly type it in if I wanted to. This is a drop-down menu for document type. So you can see that these are options that are pre-populated in there. And you can just hit that drop-down menu and select the most appropriate option. This is really a great feature for organizations that want to standardize the process. Yeah, names are going to have to type in, but document types are static. You know, they're not really variable. And I don't want some people to type in INV or INV period or capital I or lowercase I or full version of invoice. I want to standardize that process. So these drop-down menus make it take it down the path quite a way. So we're going to select invoice, and it also streamlines the process and makes it a little quicker. And then the date field. Now, date fields are going to automatically populate with today's date. However, you could always just hit that little calendar icon and then select whatever date you'd like it to be. Let's go ahead and make it for the last day of the month. And you can see it's been highlighted now. And at this point, we're done. We filled in our appropriate information, and it's time to go ahead and commit that document to storage by hitting the Save Index. Now, once I do that, it's going to bring us up to kind of like the receipt. If you will, this will say, hey, this is kind of confirming. You get a thumbnail of the document. You see your blue hyperlinks. These are your privileges. And you stored this document in the accounting cabinet as an account name of test company for an invoice dated for the 31st. And then from there, you can go on and do whatever you need to do. While we're here, let's talk about what you can do with a document. And these are the privileges that we spoke about earlier when we were talking about the rights that we give a user. Now, I'm signed in as administrator, so I'm going to see all of the bells and whistles that are available to me. And what does that mean? When I run into a cabinet and I run a search and I find documents, what could I do with that particular document? And these hyperlinks that you see across the top and these hyperlinks that you see across the bottom are the privileges that you can give or revoke from a particular individual when you bring them on into a particular cabinet. So view document opens up the document in the viewer so that you can look at it and make sure you're doing what you need to do, your call to action. Adding it to your bookshelf, like what we talked about in the beginning, under the quick stats, the main screen, this will allow you to get immediate access to that particular document. We support notes or correspondence at the document level. So this will allow you to say, let's say we had a phone call with test company and we were disputing the quantity that was associated with this particular invoice. At this point, I want to be able to denote this so that somebody else would identify this information and what transpired. So I'm going to click Add Note. And everything in Sentry File is wizard-driven, so you kind of just follow the bouncing ball, and you'll get there. So here's where I can say, you know, I spoke on the phone, and they are correcting the quantity. And then you hit next and you hit finish. And what we've done now is we've attached a correspondence or a note to this particular document. And we've also maintained the integrity of the document. And what this will do is it'll display the note for all to see. And then it'll also say who added the note and when did they add the note. So if my counterpart, my coworkers found the document later, they saw something was difficult about this particular document, they could read the note and they could add their own notes to it, and you can see a running total of notes down below. It's a great feature right there. Attachments allow you to have related documents, an invoice to a PO, a check to a contract, whatever it may be. And this is where you could attach documents together. Emailing documents out of the system is very simple. Again, if this is a privilege that you want somebody to be able to have, this will allow you to communicate documents outside of Sentry File to other recipients. You just simply click the email option, and this will allow you to send the email directly to my personal email so that I can use my contacts or my personal email to send it out. It does integrate with Outlook, or you can use the web client here. So a couple of different options to accommodate how you'd like to communicate the document out. And then delete the document. If the document was stored incorrectly, you could absolutely just delete it out of the system. Typically, we don't give most users the deletion rights option. The full record is what we're looking at right now. So this would simply take us to the full record where we can see the document. And this will also refresh it so we can see that we've identified that there's a note associated with the document. And when a user clicks on it, they'll see that right there. So the full record allows us to see just the document, all of its iterations. Remember, we talked about the ability to do revision control. And if we wanted to see the previous versions of the document, if they had been revised, if we expand this menu, you'd see all the previous versions of the document, as well as who made the revisions and when they were made. And this is all under full record. Binders is where we would go to associate this document with a pre-created binder, like one of the three binders we talked about earlier, or we could start a new binder with this as being the initial document. All of that's really driven through clicking on this binders eye here. If we accidentally chose the wrong date for this particular invoice, or misspelled the name, or selected the wrong document type, I can modify the index, and this would allow me to adjust accordingly to what I need to do. Again, based on the privileges that I've associated with myself. Saving a copy of the document out of Sentry File to my local workstation, that's what the save is doing for us right there. And revising it is part of that revision control where I can take the document and check it out, basically revise it into an editable format where I can then make the change and check it back in. Moving documents allows me to take it from one filing cabinet. So from my accounting cabinet, I could move it into a secondary cabinet. Let's say we've further delineated our accounting department with multiple cabinets and we have a cabinet just for invoices. Well, this would allow me to take this from my accounting cabinet and move it to my invoice cabinet if I wanted to do that. Appending a document is a great feature. This allows me to take my single page PDF invoice and attach other documents to it. It's a little different than attachments because I misspoke when I said attach. It's allowing me to literally increase the number of pages that this particular file has. So for instance, I can go through here. I can scroll through and browse to my computer to find a particular document. Maybe it was the second side. Maybe it was the terms and conditions that I forgot to add in at a later time. I select the item. I can even choose where it goes, the beginning of the document, after a certain particular page. We'll just put it at the end of the document. And now I'm going to append the pages. Now, when I look at the document, it was originally a single page invoice. Now, if I open it up, you're going to see that it's now a two page document with back-to-back documents. And this will allow you to put as many pages as you want into the system right there. So great feature. Delete pages. Again, let's say I scanned it in and I didn't really mean to add that second page. Maybe I scanned in the backside and it was blank. This will allow you to go through there and delete the pages. Again, maybe not necessarily an option that we give everybody in the system. Completely dependent upon how they want to have it structured. And then finally, the history of the document. And this will show me everything that's happened to this particular document. Who's accessed it? When did they access it? When was it stored? Did they add any pages to it? So it's keeping that audit trail so that we can keep track of what transpires on a particular document. So those are your privileges that you can give or take away from a user that has access to that particular cabinet. If they had view-only rights, they would only see this view link right there, and everything else will be gone. So anywhere in between from full rights, which we see here, down to a very limited scope. Now, that's great. We talked about getting documents into the system. We have a lot of options for getting documents in the system, and it's pretty easy to do, too. But if once we've populated this and really put a lot of documents into the system, if we can't find the documents relatively quickly, then it's not really going to be an effective tool. So it's got to be easy to use as far as searching. And that's where we're going to come next, is talk about searching. So we're going to expand the search options, and we're really going to give you four search engines that you can use to run queries to find the information that you're looking for. The first option is going to be the browse search, and this will allow you to, in essence, open up that filing cabinet and see all of the contents inside of it. Not a really effective way of searching, but sometimes, you know, you'll just know it when you see it. So let me see everything and scroll until I find exactly what I'm looking for. And you can set your default parameters as to what it's sorting by, but you choose the cabinet that you want to look through. So you would choose our accounting cabinet. What are we going to sort by? Well, let's just sort by the account name. We'll have it in ascending order, and we're going to go ahead and hit search. And what this will do is it will display all the documents that we've committed to storage inside of our accounting cabinet and all the different pages that we have to display all of our documents. The quick search is probably the most commonly used search, and I like to consider this kind of like the ubiquitous kind of Google search for your documents. So you select the cabinet that you want to search through, you type in any key parameter that you're looking for, so just show me everything that pertains to the word text or test, and when you hit the go button, what it's going to do is it's going to run a search through all of those tags with that particular word. So test company came up, and I'm seeing test company's invoices, test company's checks, test companies, bill of ladings, test companies, you know, you name it. They're all right there. And that's great. But let's say it's a little too extensive of a list. Let's narrow it down a little bit. So just like you would in all those other internet search engines, if I went in there and I typed in Dan, I'm going to get a lot of hits. If I went into that search engine and I typed in Dan Watson Century File, my results start to narrow because I'm putting limiters in there. Same concept here. So I can go to quick search and I can say test company and let's look for bill of ladings. So really we're limiting it to only displaying documents that equal test and bill, or bill of ladings and test company. And now when I hit search, what's going to happen is it's test company, bill of ladings, and these are the only documents. And now I've limited that search to a subset of documents that are really interesting to me. And this is great because you saw that we had a lot of documents before, and it's very easy to set those parameters to find what exactly we're looking for. The next kind of search is the index search, and this is a great way for really kind of data mining or being able to compare and contrast or kind of really looking into the system to try to find a subset of documents that you want to find. So what this would allow me to do is I could go into my accounting department again, and let's say there's a discrepancy in the month of January or February. We can't really find out where it is. So we really need to go through and we need to look at these invoices in the month of January and February. We don't know who the vendor was. We just know there's a discrepancy. So this is a very powerful tool. This would allow us to go into the accounting cabinet, select the document type to equal invoice, and then we can set the date range. So let's say I want to see all of the invoices that happened after, or let's say January 1st, and let's put that before March 1st. So what we've done is we've created, out of all my bill of ladings, all my contracts, all my invoices, all of my checks, I've limited to only invoices. And out of all of the invoices that I've had, I've limited it to a subset of only January through February. And at this point, I'm going to change the view from records view, where we saw the thumbnails of all of our documents, into a grid view. Both views are available to us at all times. And I'm going to hit this run search. And this is a great option because this allows me to get then kind of start to do some data mining in almost like an Excel spreadsheet type of report. And now I can go through here and I can look and I can see, that's probably the one that we've got a challenge on. I can hover over it. I can get the thumbnail. I can select the document. There's my discrepancy. It was this particular document. And now I can go back and do my call to action or make my calls or my adjustments or whatever I need to do. So it's a great way of really doing some data mining. I can see multiple companies that are displayed here because I didn't limit it based on the company. I limited it based on the document type and the date. And when you're talking to somebody that's involved in the accounting type of department, this is a fantastic tool, and it's very, very useful and really can help streamline the process on getting to that answer that much faster. And that's called the index search. Now, the final search that we want to talk about is called the browse search. And I'm going to use a different browser for this one just because I want to showcase how we can use Mozilla or Firefox or Chrome or whatever it is. We're using Firefox in this one. They all operate the same way. And what I want to do, and it's one thing to find a particular document. So here's this test company invoice. And we see all the information about it, test company, invoice, the date. We see who stored it, when it was stored. But it doesn't really tell me anything about the content of the document itself, the words embedded inside the document. And let's say I really wanted to find who was my widget supplier. I can't remember if it was Test Company, if it was JKL Company, or if it was ABC Company, but I need to find who supplies my widgets. And specifically maybe the red widgets, because maybe the unit price is off or maybe something's happening, and we want to find that. But it's been a while, and I don't know, and I don't want to sit there and open up my physical filing cabinet and read every word on every invoice. So that's where full text searching really comes in handy. And this will allow you to select your cabinet that you want to search through. So we'll go through our accounting cabinet. And now we can type in our keyword. What are we looking for? We're looking for our widget. Right, we're going to select our widgets, and I'm going to enable keyword highlighting. And what this is going to do is now when I hit search, now it doesn't care about the account name or the title or the document type or the date to which it was stored or anything like that. What it did, it actually searched all of the words embedded in the document itself. It doesn't matter if it's the first page or the 10th page, and it brought back the results because these documents contain the word widget. So now I can click View Document, and when I bring it over here on the screen so everyone can see it, there it is. It'll actually highlight the word for me, and I can see, oh great, Test Company was the supplier of my red widgets, and now I can give Test Company a call and do whatever I need to do. So CenturyFile does run a full text search, and it's available in all versions of CenturyFile, and it would allow you to search any word embedded in this document. So I could search for the word business, or I could search for the word company, or make, or generic needs, or invoice, or any of the words embedded in this document are searchable within CenturyFile using that full text search. It's a great way of really streamlining that process and finding that information that may be a little bit more difficult to find. As a brief overview for CenturyFile, that's really it. That kind of concludes my presentation today. And you can see all your hyperlinks are right there that we just talked about. So if you have any other questions, please feel free to reach out. We'd be more than willing to help you out. I hope you have a wonderful day. Again, I've been Dan Watson with CenturyFile. Thank you very much.